evening. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of February 4th. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight, and I'll be presiding tonight. We precede each meeting before we convene with an opportunity for the public to weigh in. It's our public comment section, and we ask that when you come up, state your name and your address. You are not limited by topic, but you are limited by time. We allocate 3 minutes for you, and in the interest of moving things along, so you should also know the council cannot respond to any questions or points that you make. It's your turn to talk and our turn to shut up and listen. So we have quite a few people signed up, so what I'll do is I'll call them in the order that they're signed up here. And then first off, we have Hildegard Friedman.
Hildegard Friedman, 175 High Street in Florence. Before I begin, I was under the false presumption that Cindy was receiving a Fox newspaper copy from December 15th from the mayor's office about this grant. I'll be sure that it's with you long before the next meeting. So this is forging new alliances. It's a police matter, and it's going somewhere because Mayor Bianchi going out of office in Pittsfield, December 15th, 2015 newspaper article, Berkshire Eagle, has received $5 million spread over a 10-year period for an anti-crime program. Very unique. I'd like to be included, even if only as a mentor. I'm not doing this just as Billy Graham. I like where this program is taking the police, and I alluded to the grant a couple of weeks ago here, but since that time, John Cartledge, has the paperwork and is working with the grant writer. We don't have the FBN, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, at the helm with the police anymore, and we have an entirely different wolf to combat when they go into the street or try to go into a home. The program literally gets police in the door with some arm of a social work department or a mentor, and to anyone who has any drug history at all, not only people that have been indicted or have been convicted, not only people that have moved into the police station from being picked up. It gives them subsidized employment. And I'm trying to do I'm proposing a different twist of this, that the police are entirely at the helm, and that the mentors and social workers are under the aegis of the police department. So the grant, I'm proposing that it should not go to the mayor, which transpired in Pittsfield. Police know crime. They are operating this in the other way in Pittsfield. Give the grant to the police, let them lead the way, and to the police of Northampton, who give their ultimate, as other police do, their life. Why don't we even have in a someday election not a four-star general, but a police officer for president? I'll have more information, and they'll have everything at their fingertips at the next meeting.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next up, Adele Franks.
My name is Adele Franks. I live at 123 Black Birch Trail in Florence. And I'm here to speak in support of the City Council resolution opposing the provisions of H-3854. I work with Climate Action Now here in the Pioneer Valley, and I also work with a statewide coalition called Mass Power Forward, which is devoted to turning Massachusetts into a 100% renewable energy state. Both CAN and Mass Power Forward were horrified to see the solar net metering bill that came out at the end of November. and was passed very rapidly by the House just before they broke for the holidays. This really horrible bill is now in conference committee, and its outcome is very unclear. The relevance to Northampton is that we have several large municipal solar arrays that are stalled because we've already reached our cap for net metering here in National Grid territory. So what's relevant to Northampton about this horrible bill, H3854, is that, first of all, it only raises the cap by 2%, which won't help us at all. It will probably clear the queue of projects that have been stalled and are already approved. But we're not even in the queue yet, so it won't help us one bit. Secondly, it reduces the net metering compensation rate by 75% for large arrays like the ones that we're proposing to build here, which would drastically reduce the financial case for installing these solar arrays in the first place, because the revenue stream would be so reduced that it's practically not worth it. And then lastly, there are other provisions, but I'm just emphasizing these three. It would allow the utilities to slap a mandatory minimum monthly charge on all solar users, including homeowners with rooftop solar. And the mandatory minimum would be up to a certain amount, but the more solar energy that you would generate, the higher this monthly fee would be, which, of course, for large solar arrays like the ones we want to build, would add up to a lot of money, which would further reduce the financial benefit of building the arrays in the first place. So we in Mass Power Forward believe that municipalities across the state need to really raise their voices and raise their objections loud and clear and demand something better than H3854. So I believe that this proposed resolution, sponsored by Council President Dwight and Councilor Klein, would in fact do this, and it would reinforce earlier communications from Mayor Narkowitz and from Northampton's Energy and Sustainability Commission to leadership in Boston about this issue and the urgent need to eliminate the net metering cap. So I hope that you will approve this resolution, and I guess that's that.
Thank you. Marty Nathan.
Hi, thank you very much. I'll be very brief. Marty Nathan, 24 Massasoit Street. I'll be very brief. I want to speak to the issue of jobs. We have a friend who just lost her job because of H3854, actually because of the lack of raising of the cap on net metering. And H3854 wouldn't do her any good. There are 15,000 solar-linked jobs in the state of Massachusetts. Some of them, many of them right here in Northampton, should those large arrays be able to be built, that those 15,000 would expand. We need to think about those people and our economy. We have to think about our future and our kids' future. Global warming is happening much, much faster than anyone expected it to. The ocean sink for both acid and heat is filling up much faster than was ever expected. Last year was the hottest year on record. And in order to be able to combat this at all, we must sink huge resources into conservation, solar, wind, and other forms of renewables. And Massachusetts should be a leader in this. It has been a leader. This bill, 3854, is keeping us from maintaining and extending that lead. We're really proud of you guys. If you pass this resolution tonight, it will mean a lot in terms of where Northampton sides for our kids' futures. Thanks.
Robert Baird, please.
Hi, I'm Robert Baird. I live at 37 Jerson Drive. And I'm also the co-chair of the Ward 6 Association. I'd like to express my concern about Northampton being a host city to the marijuana festival that's been in the newspaper. I believe this type of event does not match the image or culture of our city. Additionally, I'm concerned about the impact on our public safety resources This festival that has been in Amherst has grown larger and larger every year. Last year, there were over 6,000 people at this festival where people openly use marijuana. I'm concerned about the accessibility of this event to minors. And I stand with Councillor Marianne LaBarge and ask the City Council to allow an open public hearing for all city residents to be heard regarding this matter. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Barbara Rokoska, please.
Hi, I'm Barbara Rokoska, 571 Florence Road. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. Actually, everything I was going to say has pretty much been covered so far. I also am asking you to go ahead with the proposal for the net metering, the R16.027. If the city is not allowed or with resources can't do the solar projects they want, it will impact the city's emergency services also, because that will help them power systems for the fire rescue, the hospitals, and the DPW if we're in an emergency. This type of thing we really need, and Northampton has always been a forerunner in a lot of things. We're on the map for a lot of things, and I'd like to see this resolution pass and go on to the committee. And the other thing I was going to say is about the extravaganza. We do think it's not just a Ward 3 problem. It will affect the whole city. And I do have an issue with people being allowed to do something illegally because it's a big program. And we do know that everybody's going to smoke, which is everybody's prerogative. But if it's illegal, it shouldn't be allowed. And what is going to be the legality that the fairgrounds are going to have to handle? And our police and everybody are going to be really strapped throughout the city, because this place comes right off of 91. It's not like Amherst where people had to really go to it. You're going to get a lot of people from a lot of areas coming in. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ruth McGrath, please.
Good evening. My name is Ruth McGrath. I live at 52 Longview Drive in Florence, and I'm also the secretary for the Ward 6 Association. I'm here this evening to introduce you all to West Farms Cemetery. West Farms Cemetery is located on West Farms Road in Florence. The first burial in the cemetery was Mrs. Freelove Johnson. She was 25, and she was buried on August 27, 1788. The cemetery has a ton of history. Although her gravestone is illegible, it can be located on the left side of the cemetery between the second and the third rows. The last recorded burial in that cemetery was 2011. It's a small cemetery with 364 identified graves. We also have a page and a half of names that have been targeted as potentially buried there, but we have no proof of that yet. Counted among its celestial residents are 4 Revolutionary War veterans, 15 Civil War veterans, 3 World War II veterans, and 1 veteran from the French and Indian Wars. The 4 Revolutionary Wars fought in the Shays Rebellion, actually right here in Northampton. There were 4,000 soldiers, and these 4 that are buried in West Farm Cemetery were in that group. They weren't killed in that battle, but they were fought right here in Northampton. The cemetery is in deplorable condition, as can be expected in a cemetery this old. Stones have eroded beyond reading, have fallen over, and have broken. Some have actually been piled up 2 and 3 together. While riding her bicycle past West Farm Cemetery, Wendy Foxman noted the serious condition problems. She contacted City Councilor Marianne LaBarge. Councilor LaBarge is leading a group of concerned citizens who have begun efforts to document, clean, restore, and preserve the cemetery. We've met with many people, including Edward Huntley, past director of DPW, Richard Parcelletti, Northampton Streets and Cemeteries, and David Drake, chair of Northampton's Historical Commission. While doing research, we contacted Jane Slattery, who has a comprehensive history of West Farm Cemetery on the Find a Grave website. Our work began in July of 2015, and it's still continuing. For anyone who is excited by history or by old cemeteries, the Friends of Lilly Library have arranged to hold their yearly cemetery tour at West Farm Cemetery this year. It's June 4th at 2 p.m. I hope to see you there, and I hope that amongst us we can save some of the history and the valuable information that's located in the cemetery. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Excuse me, Julie Hudson.
I'm getting over a little bit of a cough, so you'll have to forgive
me. You're not alone,
Yeah, exactly.
Plague house.
Thank you so much. I'm Julie Hudson. I live at 98 Market Street in Northampton. So I'm here to really support the City Council on your resolution against H-3854. I think it's very well written. I think it makes a lot of excellent points, and I really support you calling on the state to eliminate the cap on net metering. However, at this stage, I feel like you shouldn't include the phrase of at least 6% in the resolution. I don't know if it's too late to change that, but I feel like making that concession at this point is not necessary because you make excellent points as to why the net metering cap should be eliminated. And the other reason why I'm opposed to you including the 6% phrase is because that might get us, you know, a few more projects through at this point, but I don't think it's enough to get us to where we need to be as a state or where we need to be as a country with climate change. The other thing I wanted to point out is that Massachusetts spends $22 billion a year on energy, and $18 billion of that leaves the state. So the more renewable energy that we can have in this state means more jobs for our state and more control over our energy. So I really commend you on writing an excellent resolution, and I hope you go forward with it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Sharon Moulton, please.
Oops, sorry. I'm Sharon Moulton, and I live at 48 Evergreen Road in Leeds, Unit 313. And I'm here in support of the resolution on net metering and global and solar energy. I'm also on the steering committee of Climate Action Now. And the main different thing that I want to say is that I want to say thank you for the leadership that Northampton takes and is taking, and that each of you should think about who you know in other places in the state that might not be as progressive as we are. And I'll just tell you that I've talked to my Republican son-in-law in Webster about the reasons that he should be calling his Republican legislators and supporting solar energy. So that's just my message. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrew Milliken.
Good evening. I'm Andrew Milliken. I live at 15 Park Avenue in Northampton. And I'm also here speaking in favor of the solar legislation resolution asking the state to reject the solar provision of the proposed energy bill, H-3854. As a conservation biologist who assesses the impact of climate change on fish and wildlife and plants and their ecosystems, I'm very aware of the importance and, most importantly, the urgency of reducing carbon emissions to allow these natural resources and the communities that depend on them, including Northampton, to adapt and, in fact, really to survive in the face of climate change. Reducing our dependence on fossil fuels and supporting renewable low or no carbon energy sources is critical. I commend Northampton on its leadership in this area in the past and on the draft resolution, and I urge you to pass it and send it on to the state. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And Jasper Lapienski, please.
Oh, that doesn't do anything. I forgot about that.
It's picking.
For start, I'm Jasper Lapienski. I live at 43 West Street. For starters, some of you may already know this, but I am one of the 15,000. I work in solar, and my job is entirely dependent on net metering. So what I want to do is explain to you the reasons why I oppose this resolution. The first thing I want to say is that I don't have a lot of respect for the people that have come up here and spoken in favor of it. Many of them drove here to city council meeting to tell you that they support solar energy, and they didn't actually disclose that in their comments, which is really despicable. But as far as the net metering cap goes, there are a lot of bad things about it. It probably should be expanded. But as far as a city council is concerned, you're completely missing the point. So here's the thing. You all know what net metering is. It's not a form of energy. It's a form of accounting. And what it does is it makes solar energy more affordable, more feasible in the context of a carbon-based energy economy. Net metering gets us nowhere. It doesn't. It doesn't do anything. It does not allow us to do anything other than be completely and totally dependent on the natural gas-fueled electrical infrastructure that we already have. So I would say that while the House bill is probably bad, and I haven't read it, but I would certainly oppose it, the resolution that you're about to pass is basically going to say, we, the city council, are big environmentalists, and we don't really want to do anything about it except complain. There's lots of things the city council and the city could actually do with or without an increase in the net metering cap. The reason that the net metering cap is important to you is because that's the only thing that you can do without spending money. But the city of Northampton could afford to be more environmentally friendly if it wanted to. And I think that this shows that what we're really interested in here is driving to city council meetings so that we can say that we're against driving. Thanks.
Thank you. That's all we have signed up. Does anyone else wish to speak at this time? Yes, sir, and then you're next.
So I apologize for being late. I walked. My name is David Reutman, and my wife Susan and I live at 575 Bridge Road, the Gables condos, and we're strong supporters of the solar legislation resolution. Two comments. The first is personal. Second is a very brief political analysis. On a personal note, my wife explored with our condo association if we could install solar. Didn't work out. We investigated community solar options. Last spring, we signed a contract with Community Energy out of Pennsylvania. We do like to support local businesses, but there was no local community solar option available right now. We wanted to get solar going as soon as possible, but as you know, the net metering caps have prevented Community Energy from building a local solar array. So our contract with them is on hold, as many other people as well. We also have a friend, still personal, point, who was hired by a solar company to start a Western Massachusetts branch last September in Pioneer Valley. She hired several dozen people and had her operation well up and running. In December, due to the unfavorable bill, 3854, looking like it might pass, the solar company closed down this Pioneer Valley branch. And I'm sure there are hundreds of similar personal stories in the 175 Massachusetts communities where solar is stalled. So with regard to the politics and economics, Hampshire Gazette published Representative Cocut a few months ago citing the Net Metering and Solar Task Force finding that each dollar invested in solar now would bring in a return of $2.77. So that's a huge positive for Massachusetts citizens. It's based on the fact that solar's benefits far outweigh its costs. So how did you get from $1 to $2.77? reduction in air pollution, reduced need for utilities to generate or purchase additional electricity, creation of new jobs, et cetera. So with all due respect to the previous commentator, I don't see any reason why you can't pass the resolution and, if you so choose, do more to support solar energy in our community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, everyone. My name's Margaret Bullitt Jonas, 83 Bancroft Road, and I walked here, and I, too, am sorry I was too late to sign in. I just would like to add my voice to all the voices that are offering thanks to you all for your leadership around turning us toward a more energy efficient and safe and sustainable world. I want to thank, I am proud to be part of this city. I want to support your solar legislation resolution. It's beautifully argued. It takes into account the urgency of the crisis we face as we address climate change. And just to add to the voices that have already spoken, I'll just add a word of support to what Julie Hudson said about taking out the at least 6%. Let's make this resolution as strong as it can be. I'm an Episcopal priest, and I work for the Episcopal Diocese of Western Massachusetts as the missioner for creation care. So I go around preaching about the urgency of climate change, and to me it's a deeply spiritual and moral issue. It's an existential issue of how much, given how smart we are, and we can see what's happening, and we see what's coming if we don't change course, now's our chance to change course. And the gift of being alive at this particular moment in history is we have a chance to make a difference, to change course, to protect the whole web of life, which is presently unraveling. I mean, to wake up this morning and walk out the door, and it's, I don't know, you know, whatever it is, 50 degrees on early February. I mean, we all know something unprecedented is happening, and it's happening in our lifetime and on our watch. So I'm grateful to all of you for your leadership and your I think that this resolution, as you're clearly saying, it would release the city of Northampton to be able to do these wonderful solar arrays and to be really a beacon of light in this state. And so I appreciate all of you. Thank you for your vision and your dedication.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Thanks. My name is Robert Jonas, and I live at 83 Bancroft Road. And I'm the board chair of the Kestrel Land Trust. We have been discussing the problem, the crisis of climate change now for a couple of years, looking for solutions that would help us accomplish our mission, which is to protect the forests and the watershed, the air quality, and the farms in the Pioneer Valley, and anything that we can do to move us more quickly in this direction is what we need. And I love this resolution. We didn't take a board vote on this yet, but I know the board well enough to say that the board would be enthusiastic about this resolution. And I agree for all the reasons that have been mentioned. And also, I agree with my wife. Thank you. Smart enough to, and we walked here, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak at this time? Before we call the roll, I'd like us to take a moment of silence for reflection on the recent passing of Ned Huntley, the former director of the Department of Public Works, a truly dedicated public servant, an enormous loss to the community and his family. So if we could just take a few moments. Thank you. Thank you. I'll ask the administrative assistant to call the roll, please.
Councilor Bidwell.
Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Here.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Sherrill.
Here.
We have a quorum. Councilors Murphy and Adams are absent with excuse. And we, on our agenda, we get to tick through like the first five items without actually having to do anything. The mayor's not present. We have no proclamations. We can do 1 minute announcements, though, if any council is inclined. Councilor O'Donnell.
I'd just like to announce next Thursday, February 11th, there will be the second community forum on Bridge Street Cemetery and the preservation master plan being developed. Martha Lyon will summarize the draft report so far and invite public comment. And so that is Thursday, February 11th, from 7 o'clock to 8:30 at the Senior Center.
Any other announcements?
Yes, PM. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so let's get right to it. First thing up is a resolution. This is item A, 16.027. This is a resolution opposing the provisions of House Bill 3854. There's a request for two readings, and I'll explain why if the motion is put on the floor.
Second.
As you understand, it's in conference committee, and there's an aspect of urgency here because we are reinforcing letters already sent by the Energy Commission, I think, as Adele pointed out, and also the mayor, emphatic letters emphasizing their objection to this particular bill that's being proposed. And so if we wait till our next meeting, this will just be a very empty and hollow gesture. So that's provided, of course, that we approve. So that's why the request for two readings. I also have some amendments I want to propose on this without objections. And the first amendment will be, excuse me, I'm going to count the whereases here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, the 11th whereas, and I'll be reading this in its entirety for everyone's thrill in a moment, but I would like to strike whereas the state of California this month withstood pressure from utility companies to lower net metering credits for solar owners and voted to retain net metering compensation at the full retail rate. I'd like to strike that, particularly it's extraneous and it's not especially relevant at this point. More relevant is what you heard Marty Nathan refer to, and you heard Mr. Lapiansky refer to, is whereas the solar industry in Massachusetts has created 15,000 jobs that provide tax revenue and support community stability. So that would be the, and I have the amended language for you, so I can send it to you. But I'll accept a motion and for that amendment.
Aye. Yes.
And okay, any discussion on the amendment? Actually, would you prefer I read the whole thing first in its entirety and before we start debating amendments? Okay,
yes.
I'm sorry. Okay. This is a resolution opposing, and this is item R-16.027, that's in our order, a resolution opposing the provisions of H 3854, and be it resolved by the City Council, City of Northampton, and City Council. Whereas global warming, caused primarily by the burning of fossil fuels, is a serious threat to the current and future generations in Northampton and around the world. And whereas the recent Paris Climate Accord called for countries around the world to curtail burning fossil fuels in an effort to control climate disruption. And whereas the Commonwealth of Massachusetts set ambitious goals for carbon emissions reduction in the Global Warming Solutions Act. And whereas Northampton is a proven leader in sustainability, having demonstrated this leadership in various ways, such as Sustainable Northampton Master Plan, membership in Cities for Climate Protection and designation as a Massachusetts Green Community, promotion of a successful Solarize Northampton program, expansion of the bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure, construction of LEED certified municipal buildings, and endeavoring to construct a large solar array on a municipal capped landfill. And whereas the City of Northampton is among 175 other municipalities affected by the current net metering cap, and whereas the City of Northampton has several ambitious plans in development to install solar arrays to reduce its carbon emissions, to help reduce its electricity costs, and to help increase resilience in the face of severe weather events that disrupt the power grid And whereas these plans for solar arrays on our capital landfill and to strengthen our emergency power system with solar arrays and battery storage at our fire rescue headquarters, our regional Red Cross shelter, our local hospital, and our Department of Public Works are all installed by the current net meter, are all currently stalled by the current net metering cap. And whereas the Massachusetts Municipal Association adopted on January 23, 2016, a resolution supporting a strong and enduring local, state, federal partnership to protect the environment, wherein they call for the legislature and Governor Baker to develop a balanced long-term strategy plan with a range of energy sources to ensure a diversified and sustainable energy supply for residents, businesses, and communities. And they further call to lift the net metering cap on solar projects to allow all current and future municipal projects to go forward and further preserve a net metering credit at the full retail rate for municipal projects with no surcharges or offsetting costs charged by utilities which could affect savings. And whereas Bill H-3854 currently in conference committee at the State House would not raise the net metering cap sufficiently to allow Northampton solar plans to proceed, and whereas Bill H-3854 currently in conference committee of the State House would decrease the net metering compensation to the wholesale rate and would allow the utilities to impose a mandatory minimum monthly charge, each of which would drastically reduce the fiscal benefit to the City of Northampton of these planned solar projects, and whereas a recent decision in Nevada that reduced the solar net metering compensation rate has already resulted in the loss of hundreds of solar industry jobs and public declarations on the part of the solar industry that it will abandon doing business in that state. And whereas, and this is the clause that I asked to have amended, the state of California this month withstood pressure from utility companies to lower net metering credits for solar owners and voted to retain net metering compensation at full retail rate. Therefore, be it resolved that the city council of the City of Northampton is vigorously opposed to the provisions of H-3854 that would reduce the net metering compensation rate to wholesale rate for sizable solar arrays, that would arbitrarily allow mandatory minimum monthly charges on solar customers, and that would raise the net metering cap by only 2%, which is insufficient to allow Northampton solar plans to come to fruition. And be it further resolved that the City Council of the City of Northampton endorses recent communications from our mayor and from our Northampton Energy and Sustainability Commission to state leadership making the case for eliminating or substantially raising the net metering cap and supports the Massachusetts Municipal Association's recent resolution calling for the same. And be it further resolved that the City Council of the City of Northampton endorses the Attorney General's study showing that energy efficiency and growth of renewable energy can make it unnecessary to expand our fossil fuel reliance through natural gas pipelines. And be it further resolved that the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to consider the consequences on Massachusetts municipalities as it considers what action to take on the solar net metering. And be it further resolved that the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to eliminate the cap on net metering or raise it by at least 6% to allow projects in the planning stages to come to fruition. And be it further resolved that the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to forego any other changes to the current solar programs until the state legislature considers long-term solar goals and fully and publicly studies both the costs and benefits of local energy determining any changes to the net metering compensation rate or the imposition of mandatory minimum charges. And finally, and be it further resolved, the copies of this resolution will be sent to Senate President Rosenberg, House Speaker DeLeo, Representative Cocott, Governor Baker, and members of the Conference Committee, Senators Downing, Pacheco, Tarr, and Representatives Golden, Dempsey, and Jones. So that is the resolution. We are now at the amendment for the strike and the replacement. Any discussion on that in this context? All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? I'd also like to add, this is at the recommendation of Chris Mason, our Energy and Sustainability Officer, and this is on the resolve, and I think it's the second further resolve, adding After the, it says, the sentence is to state leadership making the case for eliminating or substantially raising the net metering cap, and inserting after cap at the retail rate without adding minimum monthly charges on solar customers.
That insertion?
Excuse me?
I'll move that insertion.
Okay, and a second. Okay. Any discussion on the insertion?
Could you repeat the language, please?
Yeah, the line is at the retail rate without adding minimum monthly charges on solar customers. Any further discussion on that?
I'd just like to say that I think it's a worthy amendment, because what they've figured out is that for residential solar customers, it could cost a minimum of $360 with this minimum charge, and significantly more for businesses and municipal arrays. So, you know, it negates the investment they've already made in solar to have to pay these kinds of charges. So I think it's a really important amendment.
There's also another one. This is on the fifth further resolve. It reads further resolve that the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to, and at this point, insert the word immediately. That's kind of important to emphasize the point of urgency here. And remember, we're talking to the legislature, so there's room for misunderstanding. So if we allow that, so that's.
I'll move that insertion.
Oh,
point of order.
Yes.
Should we vote on the last amendment?
I thought we did.
Do
we?
Vote on the first, not the second.
Okay, I'm sorry.
So I agree, it's a really good amendment.
I'm heavily medicated at this point. I'm sorry. All those in favor of the amendment. The amendment was, and I'll repeat it, it was the insertion of the line at the retail rate without adding minimum monthly charges on solar customers. All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you, Councilor. All right. Now we have a second amendment, that third amendment.
I'll move that insertion of immediately.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on the insertion of immediately? Which out of context is a very strange sentence. So. All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? And now I think brought up, and this is entirely up to you, but I think based on the recommendation you heard coming out about the minimum setting of 6% cap, is there any discussion on that? Anyone want to propose an amendment on that?
I'd like to propose an amendment.
That's in that same resolve one we just inserted immediately, if anyone's following along at home. Councilor Klein.
Oh, I seconded your.
Oh, okay. Proposing an amendment to remove the 6%.
No, it's in the same one.
That the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to eliminate the cap on net metering or raise it to allow projects in the planning stages to come to fruition.
Actually, yeah, so what it now reads is amended. That the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to immediately eliminate the cap on net metering or raise it by, and that's how it reads now. So what language are you?
Or raise it to allow projects in the planning stages to come to fruition. So we're not offering any amount that by which it needs to be raised.
Is there a second on this, by the way?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay, Councilor Sheriff, seconded. Councilor O'Dowd.
Just a question. I mean, the current legislation does raise it, but only by 2%, I think. So it was a suggestion to just eliminate that and say that that the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to eliminate the cap on net metering to allow projects in the planning stages to come to fruition.
What about raise it significantly?
just a question. I don't know if we...
Your amendment. So.
Right.
I know.
Yeah, I'm just, I would like to have something about just that reinforces the idea of raising the net metering cap. And so I like to have that language in there, but I think you're right. You make a good point that it's already.
Just say significantly, as you just.
Yeah. Or raise it significantly.
So what is the full language of your proposed amendment?
further resolved that the City of North, that the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to eliminate the cap on net metering or raise it significantly to allow projects in the planning stages to come to fruition.
Councilor Chair.
I guess the only thing I would say is that significant can mean many different things. So it's, since it's vague, it may not have the desired effect.
Just to say, I mean, in the sense that this is a resolution, it's not a command, because the, you know, let's not delude ourselves, that I think the Conference Committee is not going to shudder at the prospect of opening the envelope and being struck by the angry words of Council in Northampton, but I don't think they'll even waste the energy to try and, no pun intended, to even try and get cute with the word significantly. I mean, I think the point is conveyed that, and it is emphasized by the fact that the idea of is to raise it enough to allow and facilitate the implementation of these projects. I mean, that's the end of the sentence. That's the coda. So, Councilor Bidwell.
Does the alternative legislation that Senator Downing, does it have a specific number in it? And if so, do we want to support a higher specific number?
Councilor Klein.
It's also 2% in the Senate bill.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
For point of information, would you like to recognize
Adele
Franks? Okay. All those in favor recognizing Adele Franks?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Adele, you may step up.
The original Senate bill just called for eliminating the cap. And then after this dreadful House bill was introduced, then Senator Downing introduced an amendment that was passed, which did have 2% in it. And then the original Senate bill has now been completely replaced by the language in H3854, so it doesn't even exist anymore.
Is there a higher standard established for a percentage increase anywhere in any proposed?
Not that I'm aware of.
Councilor Beck.
Well, it's not my resolution. I just think, to the point that they're not really going to be scrutinizing and, you know, calling their friends when they get a resolution from the City of Northampton to brag about it, and we have minimal influence. If our true position is we really think, ideally, like the original Senate bill was the best one. If our real position in our heart of hearts is that the cap just be lifted, then perhaps that's what we should just advocate for. And by, you know, logical interpretation of that is, of course, we want it as high as possible. But just a suggestion, and whatever the authors want to do.
Councilor Barton.
Yes, I like what Councilor Ryan O'Donnell is suggesting. I think that's the most important thing here, is lifting that cap, because that's what we're looking for.
Councilor Klein, this is to your amendment, so if you have any thoughts about how you want to present that.
I'm more than happy to rescind the amendment and just to remove the by, what is it, 6%. Yeah, that's fine with me.
Thank you.
Just right now is just merely delete the 6%.
Mm-hmm.
So now reads, further resolved that the City Council of the City of Northampton requests the Conference Committee to immediately eliminate the cap on net metering and or raise it to allow projects in the planning stages to come to fruition. Is that correct?
No, it's getting rid of or raise it by at least. It's just to eliminate the cap on net metering.
Okay, so we stop there right there. Okay, so it's just immediately eliminate the cap on net metering, period, and then strike the rest.
No, and then it goes on to say to allow projects in the planning stages to come to fruition. So it's just that one clause, or raise it by at least 6%, that's eliminated.
Okay. All right. So is everyone clear on what's being amended now? Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So, are there any other amendments or any other discussion on the main resolution? I mean, I'd like I'd like to say, and this has come out of discussion also in the Energy Commission, that, and you heard it on the floor too, and this also comes up in conjunction with the discussion about the development of pipelines. And what you see is the Massachusetts has rightful bragging rights about being very proactive as a rule for doing renewables, alternatives, and conservation. And on the eastern side of the state, the interest tends, according to Rep. Cocott, and I believe he's correct, tends to focus more on hydroelectricity coming from Canada, getting down to the North Shore area. The South Shore area is looking for a version of Cape Wind or tidal generation too. We don't have an ocean, we don't have a tide, we don't have the proliferation of solar is primarily out here in the western part of the state. And consequently, our influence is diminished by that, as I've said before, that our influence is only as loud as the size of our population, and our population is nowhere near the density that they have in the Boston area. So the net solarize, not only Northampton, but solarize the western part of the state has been very, very successful. And in fact, Northampton is, we've reduced, I think, close to 40% of all our municipal costs through conservation and retrofitting of all our municipal buildings. We're about to convert to LEDs throughout the whole city. We had a planned, always had for a long time, a proposed solar array on the landfill, which I personally would like to name after Ned Huntley if we get to see it. And I think that we also talked about the microgrid system mm-hmm. that you heard alluded to, which is for all emergency services and systems to function in the event that we lose power, that we have the means to sustain and provide the emergency services that with the power that we have. It reduces costs. It provides all the services that we demand in the community. It reduces the impact on global warming. We have a stormwater fee because of federally mandated changes in how we protect ourselves from the climate change. About potential flooding. They're all interwoven, and so far, H3854 runs completely counter to the energy that was, no pun intended, that was invested by the community and by the state in becoming autonomous and independent and try to contribute far less to the diminution of global climate well-being, and then also to contribute to the reduction of reliance on foreign oil and coal, reliance on foreign oil, producing carbon, and also making ourselves more autonomous in every way so that we don't have to have the horrible fights and the horrible systems that we subscribe to now. So this is it's kind of galling because literally this has gotten kind of swept up in this political football thing. I think, well, actually the governor's metaphor was ice cream cones. And I don't know if he appreciates the irony of that. But he said you can have two scoops or you can have one, but if you get one, you still got ice cream. The fact is that he's suggesting that we're just being a little too greedy. And no, we're being a little not optimistic enough. And it's not greedy, we're not taking anything from anyone. We're asking for the opportunity to improve and enhance our lot and by extension the lot of the state. So anyway, I appreciate the comments, all the comments. And I appreciate the support of this. It is with some frustration that we send this out. And hopefully it will make some, they're already heard from the mayor, they heard from the Energy Commission, we're not alone. As I said, the MMA, also the Massachusetts Municipal Association had a not very equivocating amendment. They were very clear about what they felt that should happen here as well. So, there, okay, that's my soapbox, I'm off. anyone else want to comment?
Yes, I would.
Councilor Barnes and Councilor O'Donnell.
I'm supporting this resolution 100%.
I oppose this provision of House Number 3854. And I have to say, Marty Nathan, she did an excellent job of saying exactly what this is all about. And climate change, oh, I thought you were giving that. Climate change is a really big issue everywhere. The landfill, this has a huge effect of us having solar array in that landfill. I have worked very closely with Chris Mason, Ned Huntley, and many residents on my ward. After we closed that landfill, we went and saw Mayor Nackowitz, and I mentioned that once before, and with Ned Huntley, of hoping to have that wish of solar array. And this is stopping it. And we need to move this quickly. And I agree with you, Counselor. It's extremely important that we get that solar array in that landfill and the amount of money that we're going to save in our municipal buildings. And there's a huge cost there. And there's a lot of things that we could do in this city with solar array.
Councilor Bell.
I'd like to speak in support of the resolution, but offer just a quick typo correction first.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The year should be in the year 2016. We should remind the legislature that it's the modern era, and you know, it's not 2015. And also, just a suggestion on the second page in the fourth paragraph, it just might be cleaner to eliminate the clause which was repeated in the previous paragraph, which is currently in conference committee at the State House. We say that twice. So strike that, so we would read, whereas Bill H-3854 would decrease net metering, so on and so forth.
Got it.
Just because we say currently in conference committee twice. So.
Right. Yeah. So you're asking to eliminate
technical
dependency.
Yep, and fix the year. So that's my.
Mm-hmm. I have no objection if you're advancing that as an amendment.
However you want to.
Yeah. So it's an amendment. Is there a second?
I'll second that amendment.
So the discussion is to strike the second currently in conference committee in the State House, because pretty good chance they understand what we mean. So all those in favor of the amendment?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
So could I speak generally to?
Yes, please.
I'd like to thank the counselors who wrote the resolution, Councilor Klein, Councilor Dwight, and I think, and everyone who came to support it in public comment. I think it's very important for the city, not just for the policy position that it articulates, not just because we have a very clear interest in the city of Northampton in terms of our energy future locally, but I think it makes an important point about process in our state that we're frequently on the losing end of. And the effect of this resolution is it makes this point probably in a little bit too much of a polite way. But the fact is that there are people who, as you know, with the ice cream cone metaphor, there are those who see this as some kind of subsidy or giveaway. And that's absolutely not what it is. But if it were, it's a ridiculous idea that the state of Massachusetts is not in the business of supporting certain projects and industries. The state auditor found that for the current fiscal year, there were $3.2 billion worth of corporate tax loopholes given out, the specific tax breaks and loopholes given out to specific corporations and industries. The most famous of those is the Hollywood tax credit, where we pay people to come here and make movies. But we can't take a simple step, which doesn't cost the Commonwealth anything out of its budget, to allow for a forward-thinking industry that actually creates jobs in Massachusetts, that actually allows us to bring our costs down, to allow that industry to flourish with net metering. I think it shows that our priorities and what we're willing to invest in are totally upside down. And it's important for a city like Northampton to send the message to the State House. And other cities are going to do the same thing. And I think that's an important message to send. I read in the newspaper that on Christmas Day, we broke temperature records around here. I'm not sure if it happened in Western Mass, but I read in the city of Boston, they broke their Christmas Day temperature record by 5 degrees. So all the previous temperature records in Boston were broken by 5 degrees. And I just ask, what does that trigger? What policy changes does that trigger? It should trigger something. It should make us wake up a little bit. There are other things, by the way, that get triggered automatically. A few days after Christmas, on New Year's Day, the income tax rate automatically went down because we have a law to bring it down automatically if certain economic conditions are met. And there's nothing great about high taxes in and of themselves, but if you have a tax system like we do, there's enormous inequality there, and that provision helps people who are already doing very well and doesn't help people who are struggling in the state. But that's an automatic policy trigger. What trigger happens when we pass our temperature record by 5 degrees? Does it automatically trigger a more aggressive benchmark in the state's Global Warming Solutions Act? No, that stays where it is. In fact, if we don't have this net metering cap lifted, it will be harder to meet our obligations under the Global Warming Solutions Act. I think the resolution makes that point. And the least we can do is enact this change in state law to lift the cap, to allow cities and towns to provide public safety, to allow for a local green energy future, to get us to that goal. So the legislature is going the exact opposite way than we should go, and I'm proud that this resolution sends the message that we got to turn it around, and that we don't have much time to turn it around because global warming is a crisis. And I'm glad we added the word immediately. We should add that word maybe a few more places throughout the resolution. But it's for that reason that I'm very grateful that it was written. It's very well argued, and thank you again to the sponsors.
Any further comments, discussion, questions? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Goodwill.
Yes.
Suspend the rule.
It second. Passed the first reading. There's been a motion to suspend the rules to allow for a second reading. Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? I'll accept the motion for the second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on the item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Boyd.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Goodwill.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Passes in second reading and is therefore passed and will be forwarded to the people that we listed at the end. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
We have a whole lot of meeting to go, so I'll even give you time to clear the room if you want. There's other important stuff, but, coming up, we do have the consent agenda, and I understand that there's been a request to remove item B from the consent agenda. No, is it item B?
Item B.
Adams Road.
And perhaps another item.
Item B, and then also on the item appointments, C. The appointment to the committee for approval by City Council to Gaytan Fortin.
Yes.
To be removed as well from the consent agenda.
Move approval of the consent agenda.
So there's been a motion made to move approval of the consent agenda. No debate. Is there a second?
Second.
And that's understanding those two items are removed. I'm going to read the other one. Yes. No, thank you, though. Thank you. I didn't do that last time. Thank you. So first up, we have the petition from. Boy, I skipped minutes too. So you have to hit me, Pam. It's okay. The petition from Northampton residents to accept Bottoms Road as a public way, and this is to refer to Committee on Public Works and Utilities, and the Department of Public Works and the Planning Board.
Move to refer to committee.
Oh, we're taking those first.
Oh,
that's right.
I'm just reading it. I'm reading what the consent agenda content was. So I should have probably done that before we remove the item. So And then item 16.022, this is the appointments to committees for approval by City Council, Marlene Morocco, new appointment to the City Council on Aging, positive recommendation from the City, the Committee on City Services, 4 yes, 0 no. Gaytan Fortan, reappointment to the Disability Commission, positive recommendation from the Committee on City Services, 3 yes, 0 no, 1 abstention. Next up is Cynthia Swopis, a reappointment to the Board of Health, positive recommendation from the Committee on City Services, 4 yes, 0 no. William Hargraves, new appointment to the Board of Health, it's a positive recommendation from the City on the Committee on City Services, 4 yes, 0 no. And Gerald S. Budger, who was present tonight, new appointment to the Northampton Housing Authority Board of Commissioners, positive recommendation from the Committee on City Services, 4 yes, 0 no. So the motions were made to remove the two items. B, the petition from Bottoms Road, and the appointment of Gaytan Fortan.
And the minutes are on the consent agenda as well, is that right?
Right, they are.
I might have missed it, sorry.
No, it's not your bad, it's my bad. I mentioned the minutes. Yes, the minutes of the previous meeting from January 21st, 2016.
Move to approve.
The motions were made already and seconded with those removed, those two items removed. All those in favor of the consent agenda?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Now to the two items that we culled out. This is the petition from the Northampton residents to accept Bottoms Road as a public way.
I'd like to move to refer it to the Committee on Public Works and Utilities, the Public Works Commission, and the Planning Board.
You want to explain that comment?
Oh, sure. It says that it's there for referral to the Department of Public Works, but pursuant changes to our ordinance after the mayor issued his administrative reorganization of government to section 285-32 of our ordinances, we have to refer this to the Public Works Commission and the Planning Board. And it seems like in addition to that, we ought to refer it to our Public Works Committee as well, just for scrutiny.
So that's the amendment. Is there a second on that amendment?
Second.
Discussion on the amendment for referral? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Please say aye.
What? I just wanted to ask, you said the Committee on Public Works and Utilities, mm-hmm. the Public Works Commission, and the Planning Board.
Yes. Does that, Pam, does that make sense? Or?
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, let's try again. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? So that's the amended language. All those in favor of the newly amended referral? I know the, all the, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Gaytan Fortan's reappointment to the Disability Commission. I'll accept a motion.
I abstain on that.
Right. Hang on a second.
Second.
Okay. Councilor Barge, you're abstaining. All those in favor of Gaytan Fortan's reappointment to the Disability Commission, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? And an abstention. Normally we would recess for Finance Committee. We don't have a quorum of Finance Committee tonight, which is actually okay because yeah. we don't really have, most of the things are in second reading, we do, but we will convene. We'll plow on ahead without them. So first up we have item 16.004. This is a financial order to provide funding for extraordinary maintenance at the Northampton Public School Grounds Maintenance Shop.
Move to approve.
Second.
Second reading. Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this item?
No.
Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Kearney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. So that passes in second reading. This is also second reading. Item 16.006 is financial order to purchase or otherwise acquire any fee, easement, and or any other interest in land off Old Ferry Road for $30,000.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor LeBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Kearney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item C, or 16.007, the financial order authorizing the Conservation Commission purchase or acquire any agricultural preservation restriction on 0.85 acres of farmland on Island Road for $1,000.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
D, 16.008, the financial order allowing the mayor to accept grants from the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs.
Move to approve. Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. E, or 16.009, the financial order authorizing the Conservation Commission to purchase or otherwise acquire a fee easement and or the other interests in 3.1 plus or minus acres of land located on Venturers Field Road.
Move to approve.
Second.
In second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
F, this is 16.011. $30,000 be appropriated from the CPA funding to the Broadbrook Coalition for the Fitzgerald Lake Bridge, Boardwalk, and Dock Project.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. G, 16.012, this is $30,000 from the CPA funding to move, store, and purchase historic ornamentation for the Seth Thomas clock.
Move to approve. Second it.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item H, 16.013, $200,000 from the CPA funding to the Department of Public Works for additional funding for the Pulaski renovation, Pulaski Park renovation project.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. Item I, 16.014, $3,000 to be appropriated from CPA funds for the Northampton Conservation Commission and Northampton OPS for the Mineral Hills Habitat Project.
Move to approve them.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Sorry.
You see it for being
I am really just, I am so out of it. Roll call, please. Thanks for saying aye, those of you who said aye.
Roll call. We do a little discussion? Did we have
no, we can have a discussion.
Discussion?
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry, yes.
I just want to go on record, as I did the first vote, that I don't support using CPA funds for pesticide use, herbicide use in our conservation areas, so I'm going to vote no on this.
And I'm sorry, any further discussion on this? How about a roll call?
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
No.
That passes in second reading. Item J, 16.015, $131,310 be appropriated from the CPA funds to Historic Northampton Incorporated for electrical work, roof and window replacement for Damon and Shepherd houses.
Second it.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Item K, 16.016, this is $5,000 from CPA funds to the Northampton Youth and Community Rowing for the Connecticut River Greenway Gate Project This is second reading. I'll accept a motion first.
Move to approve it.
Second.
Second.
And Councilor Bidwell?
As I did on first reading, I will disclose that I have a relationship with this organization as its founder and member of advisory board, but I'm confident that I can render an opinion without bias.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Sheriff?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Item L, I'm sorry, that passes in second reading. Item L, 16.017, $55,000 from CPA funds to the Northampton Conservation Commission and Northampton OPS for the Rocky Hill Open Space Acquisition Project.
Move to approve.
Second.
Seconded. Further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
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 Passes in second reading. Now we're up to orders. This is this will look a little familiar. This is a carryover. Item A, 15.382. This is the order regarding sick time, and that is to accept Mass General Law Chapter 149, Section 48C. The item's carried over from the 2014-2015 Council. And I'm going to read the excerpt from the City Council meetings on December 17th, 2015. Excuse me. Council Murphy pointed out that this order has been around for a while. Neither the Finance Committee nor the Committee on Rules, Orders, and Appointments and Ordinances has acted upon the order since it was introduced. Mayor Narkowitz pointed out that the city does provide paid sick time benefits for employees who work 10 hours or more, and most employees have sick time benefit that is more generous than what we would be required by state law. Most benefits are embedded in collective bargaining agreements, and Mayor Narkowitz would like the opportunity to complete collective bargaining before the City Council weighs in on this order. And Councilor O'Donnell requested that this order be carried over to the new council, that's us. And Councilor Spector seconded the motion. The motion was approved on a vote, a voice vote of 9 yes, 0 no. So, first I'll accept the motion, put this on the floor.
I'll make a motion.
Second.
The second. And Councilor O'Donnell, you want to speak to this?
Move to apologize for putting it because I know it's been complicated. I think it would be best if we send it back to the Finance Committee because I'm inclined to agree the mayor should have the opportunity to deal with collective bargaining, but I'm not prepared to just dispense with it. I'd like to see what we could do with earned sick time and fill in the areas where it may be needed. I agree, generally, we're pretty good in terms of our policy in the city, as the mayor has said, but my preference would be
the same. Yeah. And for background purposes, you'll recall the citizens of the state of Massachusetts voted to establish sick time pay for people who are not, actually, not, everyone's covered, all private employers, and the only people so far who are exempt are cities and towns. And the legislature, I'd imagine, too, because they're usually pretty well covered. So, but it was the intent of Councilor Adams, Councilor O'Donnell, and myself, and among others, that it's interesting, in order for us to actually abide by the law that was established by the voters of the state, we actually had to opt in as opposed to opting out. And in order to opt in, it will require acceptance of this council, but there are reasons that it's complicated. First of all, we're waiting for an opinion. I think still waiting for an opinion from the Attorney General. Are we?
I think I'm not sure what the status is of the Attorney General's regulations about how, because again, Northampton is one of the only cities that actually wants to opt in that I've heard of. So I don't know that the regulations are in place for how to deal with, you know, all the ramifications of that. You know, if you're a lifeguard for the summer for the recreation department, do we give you sick time? And you know, what about substitute teachers and the strange situations that the Attorney General's regulations might speak to? I think we're waiting on that.
And so, to continue, our express will and desire to opt in, provided there is a workable solution, and we're waiting to. So we are progressing towards it. We are not going to achieve it now. But the fact is that this is the will of the voters, and it has always been the will of this municipality, as you point out, we tend to be a pain in the butt for try to adhere and abide by it, not only the letter but the spirit of the laws. Councilor Carney.
Well, I was just referring back to the minutes that indicates that the mayor would like the opportunity to complete the collective bargaining before the. So I don't think that the option is to not weigh in, but to looking at the timing, would we want to let that that work around collective bargaining happen first before we weigh in on the order as the mayor has requested? And
I would think that would make sense to you. Do you agree?
Yes, I do.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Okay.
So perhaps it should go to finance while we wait for that process.
And sit in finance, wait, and just wait until the collective bargaining has completed.
I suppose so, unless it can sit in the council, but I figure.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
Where, you know,
well,
procedurally,
it sat in finance for quite a while. It sat in ordinance for quite a while, right?
And it, yes, it did. Yes.
It sat in finance for quite a while. We don't know where to park these things in that.
Right. If it sits in finance, it then appears on every. If it's in the finance,
it shows up,
on every council agenda up until the end of collective bargaining.
Right.
And so, but.
There is also tabling.
Right.
Indefinitely.
Exactly.
But that has a finality to it that is, I would imagine, is not appealing to you in that respect.
No, that just that means I don't think we can take it up again this session if we do that. Yeah. We could postpone it.
We could postpone it until after collective bargaining. I think we could be specific about that. We could just postpone until the collective bargaining has been completed, which would be before July 1st.
But you're saying when contracts are signed?
Yes. Yep. That would be amenable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, if there's some need to do it before that, I mean, in theory, we could still put it back on the agenda.
Right.
So that's not.
Yeah.
I mean, if Councilor, if you thought that's a good course, I'm happy to support
it. Well, just rather than have it appear at every council meeting up until that point.
So you're suggesting a date certain, tabling till a date certain.
Well, not till the contracts are signed.
Right.
Which isn't a date certain. It's.
Well, you're saying that they'll be signed by July, but we don't know that.
Right. So I would just say instead to say when contracts are signed. And then, with the understanding that if that's inadequate, if we find that that isn't working out for some reason, we can always bring it back onto the floor.
What about would it be acceptable to say postpone until July 1st, knowing that contracts may not be done by then, but we'll revisit it then?
That would be amenable.
Okay. So table motion to table bill
postpone
until July 1st.
Yes, that's the motion.
I'll second that motion.
Okay.
Any further discussion on that one? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay. So it's postponed until July 1st. You want to roll call?
No.
You look ready. I might. I read you wrong. Okay. This is the first reading. In case you haven't noticed, 16.024, this is a warrant for an upcoming election on March 1st, 2016, is the primary election. If you haven't noticed, we're in the middle of an election season. There's barely any discussion about it. Hardly know what's happening. But come on now. Hang on a second.
Uh-oh.
Try again. This is upon the recommendation of City Clerk Wendy Mazza that the meetings of the members of the Democratic, Republican, Green Rainbow, and United Independent Party in the City of Northampton qualified to vote will be held on Tuesday, March 1st, 2016, in several polling places designated for the purpose by the City Council. I could read these.
Wave reading.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Everyone's agreed with the. Okay. And the polls will be opened at 7 o'clock in the forenoon and close at 8 o'clock in the evening of the said day. And all members will, in the wards in which they are entitled to vote, become between said hours, given their votes for the primary officers for the election of candidates of political parties. For the following offices: presidential preference, one state committee man. Really? That's the language? One state committee man for each political party for the Hampshire, Franklin, and Worcester district.
That's
Also a woman.
It has to be a man.
Yeah, there is. It's right. The next one is one state committee woman for each political party for the Hampshire and Franklin and Worcester district. 35 members of the Democratic Ward Committee, 35 members of the Republican Ward Committee, 10 members of the Green Rainbow Ward Committee, and 10 members of the United Independent Party Ward Committee. So, I'll accept a motion.
Move to approve it.
Second.
Any discussion on the warrant?
It's a roll call.
Does that require a roll call?
That's a roll call.
Roll call, please.
Councilor Kern?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor DeBarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell? Councilor Sarah?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in first reading. We'll revisit that at our next meeting in February. Item C, 16.010. This is the order to remove requirement that hunting be allowed on the Abusa section of the Broadbrook of the Cheryl Lake Greenway. This is second reading.
Move second reading.
Second.
Second.
Motion's made second. Any further discussion? Councilor O'Donnell?
There's a question. Is there any appetite in the council to add a further order that if the conservation removes the restriction, that either the commission or the mayor cause signage to be put up so that people know about the change? I think we're changing the hunting status of a parcel. It should be advertised so this, for the purpose of public safety. Or is that just something that we trust to happen administratively and without nothing?
Councilor Klein?
Didn't this come up in first reading, and they said that it was difficult to actually put signs up that would be seen or something like that? Am I making this up? I thought that there had been discussion about that, and we were told that it was just impossible to get signage in places that were useful.
Well, I heard what I understood was that because it was kind of arbitrary, it was surrounded by areas that had hunting restrictions and some that were already allowed, and this was kind of an anomaly site, so it was hard for anyone walking through the woods trying to distinguish where it was and was not allowed.
I think,
But that doesn't preclude the posting of signs, particularly for educational purposes at the entrances or, but.
Well, I'm happy to just, I guess, defer to the Conservation Commission and the mayor, and once it's done, maybe I can make that suggestion informally.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that'd be something to bring up with content. So.
All right, thank you.
Okay, so any further discussion on this item?
Yep.
Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor O'Barr?
Yes.
Sorry, Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in second reading. Now we're into ordinances. The item A, 16.025, this is an ordinance regarding the parking on Center Street, and this is for referral to the Committee on Legislative Matters, I'm sorry, and Transportation and Parking Commission.
Move to refer.
Motion's made and seconded to refer. Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Once again, this is actually kind of a carryover. It is a carryover. This is item 15.377. This is zoning for significant trees, and the item is carried over from the 2014, probably 2015 council session, even though it says 2014 session. Rather than read the reflection of the minutes, I'll defer to Councilor O'Donnell.
I'd like to also apologize for this ordinance. This ordinance requires a hearing because it's zoning, and it had a hearing last year in then the ordinance committee. The city council is obliged to act on something that has a hearing within 90 days, and we're not going to make that deadline, so it has to have a hearing again. It does not have to go back to the planning board. We have to send it to a committee for the purposes of a hearing. I was assuming we'd send it to Legislative Matters, which is the new ordinance, but actually our administrative assistant brought up today, could it go to Community Resources and have a hearing? I don't see why not. So I would just, if the council has an opinion on that, but it does need a hearing, so it needs to be referred back somewhere. So.
I actually think it's a good idea to send it to Community Resources. give everyone a chance to stretch their legs in a committee meeting and actually have a meeting and talk about these points. Yeah, I'm open to objections, of course, but so.
I that motion.
So the motion is to refer to the Committee on Community Resources. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
For hearing. The motion's made and seconded. Any discussion?
Curb your enthusiasm.
All those in favor of the referral, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
I was just wondering if you send that back to legislative matters as well. You gave a neutral recommendation, right? Because there are no recommendation actually the rules because we'd run out of time.
Right.
Is that true? I thought we just decided. I'm talking without being recognized. I thought we just decided we would let the council, that there was improper legal form, and that's what we determined in ordinance, but we'd let the council make the decision about whether it was a good law to adopt for the city. And that's why it's neutral. It did leave the committee, I believe.
Could I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
So there was a hearing, according to the minutes here, there was a hearing at the planning board.
Yes.
So does there need to be an additional hearing beyond the one the planning board held?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if I can answer that. After that happens, a 90-day clock starts, and the city council would have to act on second reading before 90 days have elapsed. And I know the ordinance committee ended its hearing on October 16th or something, and so we're beyond that. So unfortunately, we have, because the point is we have to advertise it and tell the public about it, so yeah, so that's, it's kind of unfortunate, but that's, yeah.
I would imagine it would be a long meeting.
Right. And some councilors had questions on it, I remember at the last meeting, so we could have those aired and discussed. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it stands with just that one referral then?
I mean,
legislative matters.
Well, just a question. I mean, is there any magic to referring it to legislative matters for hearing as opposed to community resources? I mean, I know we traditionally have sent it to ordinance, which is now legislative matters, but we could always send it to both just for, to be safe.
Maybe I would just ask just a little bit more about the rationale for sending it to community resources.
Sure. Well, insofar as that it actually is, we're discussing a community resource. And that one of the reasons was because of their light agenda for me. Excuse me. Whereas legislative matters tend to be a little heavier. And this seemed to me that this actually would lend itself to a perfect venue for a public hearing for this stuff.
Thank you.
I actually think it makes sense also because I think there's an intersectionality of all kinds of departments. I'd like to see the tree commission and some others involved. And if we do a hearing in community resources, I think it's a good place to bring some of those departments and commissions together to talk about something very relevant to all of them.
Thank you.
Yeah, and to Pam's point, it is a zoning issue. Mm-hmm. So, and that's where that lies. Mm-hmm. Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you. We're almost through this. This is also for referral. Item 16.005, ordinance relevant to specifications on sign lighting in residential and commercial districts and creating specifications for dynamic display boards. This item was already referred to planning and to the Commission on Legislative Matters. City Council to consider referring to the Committee on Community Resources again. We're piling up the agenda.
Move to refer to the Committee on Community Resources.
Motion is made and seconded. This too is about the zone. Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, thank you. Last. Item D, 16.028, an ordinance to delete Chapter 290 from the city code book This is to be referred to the Committee on Legislative Matters and the Committee on Community Resources.
Move to refer.
Move to refer to Committee on Legislative Matters.
The motion's been seconded. And
just background, I mean, we had an ordinance review committee meet, and this is one of the chapters that the committee recommends deleting. Chapter 290 is the subdivision regulations, which are regulations, they're not ordinances. So in theory, there's something the planning board should adopt themselves, and that's the rationale for suggesting deleting it. So, point of information.
Thank you. Any further discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? There are no updates. Information requests? No. So new business.
Move to adjourn.
Motion's made to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very much.